if you have around about £400 to spend and you're considering buying either perhaps the BBC machine or the QL or the Amstrad, which one do you choose? Well, one of the things that might help you make up your mind is to pick up a copy of Personal Computer World magazine and read one of their regular bench tests. Now, by the merest chance, this gentleman sitting next to me, David Tebbutt, is the man who devised those bench tests for PCW magazine. And we're going to put him really on the spot because in a moment he's going to perform the very first television computer bench test. So you better get it right. To see if he does, we have a distinguished panel here to see fair play in the shape of Tony Harris, who is the publisher of PCW, Graham Cunningham there in the middle with the glasses, who is the editor of that magazine, and our resident old mate Guy Cuny, the computer journalist. So a distinguished team of experts to see if poor David Tebbutt gets it absolutely right in the very first television computer bench test right here.
I suppose the ideal computer is one which satisfies all your needs, from zapping aliens to running your business. Now, clearly, not all machines are suitable, but there are some inexpensive machines around which might do the job. Today I'm going to introduce you to three of them. First, the BBC Model B. Long in the tooth, perhaps, but still a popular choice. Then we have Sinclair's elegant but controversial QL. Finally, we have a machine from a company better known for its hi-fi, the Amstrad CPC 464. The BBC and the QL rely heavily on their technical specifications to attract buyers. The BBC, with its wide range of add-ons, and the QL, with its large memory and powerful processor, whereas the Amstrad comes across as a straightforward, ready-to-run machine. Let's see what's in the boxes. First of all, the BBC. There's the machine, the keyboard and control unit, and in the box, a user guide and a welcome pack. The QL provides a little more. In fact, we have the QL itself with its micro drives over here. And then in the box, a power supply, various leads, including a printer lead, the manual, and some software and blank cassettes. Finally, the Amstrad comes as a keyboard cassette unit, and in the box, a manual and a pack of £100 worth of software. You can either have a colour monitor with the Amstrad or a green and white plain monitor. Out of a possible 25 points, I've given the BBC 8, the QL 18 because of its micro drives and its software, and the Amstrad 20 because it's got a cassette unit, monitor and software. Different things affect the efficiency of a computer. The fastest processor in the world cannot make up for the deficiencies of a poor typist. The timings we're about to do will test the speed of the basic interpreter performing mathematically intensive tasks. We'll start the timings now and pop back later to see how they're coming along. Until computers can understand speech or thought, we're stuck with the need to communicate through a keyboard. Like a pair of shoes, it pays you to find something comfortable. The BBC has a traditional sprung keyboard. The keys feel like those on an electric typewriter or a professional computer terminal. The QL keyboard mechanism comprises a plastic moulding which forms a series of bubbles on which the keys rest. It works, but it doesn't lend itself to touch typing. The mechanism of the Amstrad is similar to the QL's, but a better design makes it much more pleasant to use. Out of 20 points, we'll give the BBC 18 for its quality, the QL 8 and the Amstrad 11, because, although they're both bubble-based, Amstrad has a better feel. To get some idea of graphics performance, we shall get each machine to perform some simple drawing routines. Each machine will be tested in its four-colour mode. The BBC can plot points and draw lines. It will fill triangles, but other shapes require some programming effort. The circle was derived from a formula rather than a circle command. Plotting, drawing and circles pose no problem for the QL. Like the BBC, filling is possible, but it requires careful thought and programming effort. Plotting and drawing are straightforward on the Amstrad, but circles and shape filling need to be programmed. Out of 10 points, the BBC gets 4 because it has a limited fill command, the QL 5 for its circles and half a fill command, and the Amstrad gets just 3, which means that Amstrad now holds onto its lead by a single point. If you're to use your computer for games or music, then you'll be interested in the range of notes, the number of channels, and the facilities for shaping the waveform of the sounds. The BBC has three sound channels, plus a noise channel. It plays just over 5 octaves, and has a decent envelope shaper. The QL provides the modestly named beep command, which provides a single channel of sound. The Amstrad provides three channels, right speaker, left speaker, and both speakers, 8 octaves plus both volume and tone envelopes. So let's check the scores. Out of a possible 5 points, the BBC gets 4 because of its smart envelope control. The QL gets 1 because at least it made a noise, and the Amstrad 4 because of its channel control and envelope shaping facilities. That leaves Amstrad still in the lead with 44 points. One of the major influences on the long-term success of a computer is the range of add-on hardware and software products available. For most people, this should be a key factor in their decision to buy. Unlike our other contestants, the BBC has been on the market for a few years now. Accordingly, you can buy just about any add-on or piece of software you could possibly need. The QL was launched in early 1984, although deliveries didn't pick up for several months. Since then, a modest but growing support industry has developed. A count of the advertisements in a recent issue of PCW showed 20 items for the QL. Amstrad is an even more recent arrival than the QL. The same search through PCW found 10 items, plus some Amsoft programs. The number of supporting products relates to the popularity of the machine and the time it's been on the market. Accordingly, we end up with 22 points out of 25 for the BBC, 8 for the QL, and 5 for the Amstrad. This means that the BBC has now grabbed a clear lead from the relative newcomers. Let's see what the final tally was in the benchmark timings. I suspect we have one or two surprises on our hands. The BBC and the Amstrad were the fastest. Out of 5 points, we'll give the BBC 3, the QL 2, and the Amstrad 4. This gives us the final tally. Out of a maximum of 100 points, the BBC scores 63, the QL 50, and the Amstrad 53. The prices are for the computers as purchased, including VAT. The BBC requires some means of storage and display. The QL2 needs a display, but does have microdrives and a range of business programs. The Amstrad comes as a ready-to-run system with a pack of 12 programs. Everyone will have a different interpretation of the final tally based on their own particular needs and preferences.
David, I rather enjoyed that. Come and take a seat, especially the bit where it dissolved into the bottom right-hand corner. Now, Tony, why do you as a publisher like to see bench tests in your magazine?
Well, we find that an enormous number of people buy the magazine specifically for to read the bench tests.
So from your point of view, it makes good commercial sense, doesn't
That's
it?
That's right, yes.
Now, from the editorial point of view, Graham, does a bench test really tell us anything, or is it just an elaborate device to fill up the pages with respect?
No, they're an excellent way of discovering by way of independent objective criteria and the weightings you've used here, how well the machines will perform for you.
Right, but do the criteria ever change? As new machines come onto the market, do you start testing new things that you formerly were not testing?
Perhaps your perspective on the machines changes as the machines become capable of doing more advanced things, but you're still, it's a very basic approach which is constant.
Right, how do you think it works on television?
Very well. A lot more exciting.
Well, yes, and you don't have to read it, that's true. Now, Guy, what are your views on bench tests in general and this one in particular?
Well, bench tests are limited. They're very valuable. What I always feel about them is that it would be nice if you could actually put some money into them. What I'd like to know is how these machines compare with an ideal machine. Do you need to spend a lot of money to make this a proper machine, like buying extra discs? And what perhaps the viewers can help us with is by giving us a few definitions of what an ideal machine might be. Would it have a portable machine? Would it have colour? All that sort of thing. I'd like to have some ideas from the viewers, and then we can compare existing machines with a real machine rather than some of them which are getting a little old-fashioned.
Seems to me what you're saying is that you're trying to institute a new benchmark for bench tests. Instead of comparing each machine with its peers, you would like each machine to be compared with some notionally perfect or ideal machine. Is that right?
That's right. I feel that the technology has advanced, but the machines haven't, and that people can see they want this machine for that feature, but they would like also to have something new. They'd like to perhaps have a colour and a black and white display. They'd like to have a portable display. They'd like to have a built-in modem. I don't know what. And they want to know how much more it would cost if they buy one of these old ones to add that. And then they can make a real comparison.
Well, maybe they'll tell us. Now, David, we had an item there that ran, what, 7.5, 8 minutes? right? And obviously it doesn't take up the same amount of space as it would in the magazine, where you can get a lot more information because it's in print. But how much work do you have to do to come to the conclusions that you gave us in that short time?
About 40 hours for each machine.
So what we saw there, and what one reads in the paper, is the distillation of, what, 120 hours worth?
That's right, yeah.
Do you ever get surprised? Do you come across a new machine that has a new feature for which you haven't got a grouping, a thing to put it in?
Well, they all deal with input, output and processing, but now and again something crops up which is really whizzo, a video disc or something like this. It goes beyond the scope of a bench test. You put it on whatever bit it belongs to.
And you get enthusiastic about it, do you?
Get enthusiastic about it, rave about it, whatever.
I see. All right, now, you may have some ideas for future bench tests, or perhaps, more importantly, you might have some ideas about what the ideal benchmark machine would be if you could only think of it, to satisfy Guy's point. If you have ideas in those areas, then by all means write to us using the good old Royal Mail, or, of course, if you're a bit more advanced, then send us an electronic mail. Our Prestale mailbox is on page 7776. That's 7776 on Prestale.